Okay. Hello, my name is Hans-Peter Görg. After all the expert talks you've heard, I now show a little hobby application for a quarter of an hour about. Therefore, the perspective is more those of an end user of the social EDE. I will say something about that, and oriented on a special business subject. I've been a long-time developer, but since 2019 I'm retired. Therefore, I have the luxury, if the weather is fine, you will find me after the behind sitting by the computer, but instead I will be on an e-bike ride, especially along the River Rhine you see here. And I think if you are in Andernach, you can see that it's really beautiful here. But when the weather is bad, and it is often bad in Germany, I still like to program for my own purposes, not for commercial use. And the second hobby I have, I'm interested in the stock market, and I invest a little bit in the stock market. And combining these two hobbies, of course, is something that was obvious to do. But before we start, as we are talking about something with money, a disclaimer: the information provided or visualized on security or investment are no advice and are no recommendation. If you invest, do it on your own risk. Don't blame me if you lose a fortune. That is, that is possible. Okay. As I'm a little bit older and I don't have so much time to recover from a big crash, of course, I must be a little bit cautious on the stock market. Therefore, I don't invest in shares of one company, let's say Microsoft or Google or something else. Instead, I use exchange-traded funds. If you don't know them, it's something like a bag, and within this bag are shares of a lot of company. You see here some examples. It may even be up to thousands. So you have a diversification with that. Diversification is the main means to reduce risk. But if you think it is sufficient, then you may be on the wrong side. This is my little application. You see here exchange-traded funds and exchange-traded commodities like gold. Of course, this is a demo portfolio, not my own. And the security IDs you see here are fake IDs because I don't want to advertise a special product. But the data I will show you, of course, is oriented on typical exchange-traded funds. So we have a look into one world ETF. If you start occupying yourself with exchange-traded fund, you perhaps think, I buy one world ETF, there may be 2,000 to 4,000 company shares within, everything is okay. But as you see here on the right side, the United States of America part here is about 60%. And you will even find exchange-traded funds with up to 70%. If we compare that to the gross domestic product of the United States, you see it has a lot, a quarter of the world GDP, but not 60%. Mm-hmm. And even if you take into account that the stock market in the United States, of course, is over proportionally good developed, that would be a risk just to accept 60%. Some experts say that perhaps 40% should be what you mostly should have invested, but it always depends, of course, on your own security ideas and your risk profile. For me, it meant that I wanted to control and to visualize it for me, because if you read just the numbers, you don't get an impression. I wanted to see how I really had, what my diversification was. And in two directions. One direction is which companies do I possess, the top stocks of them, and what is the countries their headquarters reside in. At least I think that the information you get is oriented at the headquarters. Okay, the first problem, of course, is where to get the data. The ETFs, of course, is quite easy. CVS, I think every custodian bank has a CVS file you can import. And to allow me to change the deposit bank, of course, it made it a little bit configurable. So the next thing is I need, of course, before I can make any aggregations, the data of the holdings and the data of the countries. I've been looking for web services because I, of course, didn't want to edit them myself. But I didn't find any that are not free. I think the financial markets, they know how to get the money. or if they were free, they weren't useful at all. Therefore, I just used simple desktop list boxes. I assume that doing an update twice a year should be enough, because the relation between the countries and the companies is not changing so quick. So the first thing I wanted to see is how do the exchange-traded fund I possess compare to each other? You see here, this is a polar area chart of Sojo. The size of the slice of one ETF shall give an impression of the monetary size you indirectly own of the ETF in comparison to others. The inner part here, the violet part, is the part of the top five holdings, because I wanted to see how much concentration do I have within one ETF. And you can see here, if I click on this sector, that for a typical ETF with the top 50 companies of Europe, we already have 27% of the overall share. That is a lot. This is even more in your US tech ETF. I think that could be oriented to NASDAQ 100. While others, like this mixed fund in generally isn't oriented to an index where some organizations say how much of one company has to be within one ETF, oriented to this index, is managed by some manager, and he decides what goes into it. And here you see they are a little bit more cautious. What I really like about these Sojo charts is they are super easy to program. Also, I think that is a good job that has been made. You see here, to identify the segment, and this is something you often have to do, you just use a pressed event. Inside this pressed event, you have an index. And as you give the data in an error, of course, you immediately have the data you want to have. It is interesting to compare the ETFs, but of course it is more important how much is the concentration, the clustering on the top companies. Therefore, I developed this double chart. You see here on the left side that Microsoft has about 2.8% as the most concentrated company. I think it's okay, but as always, it depends on your risk profile. And if it is higher, perhaps your performance will be better. But of course, your risk will increase too. In this case, on the left side, again, you see a social chart. On the right side, you see a tree map of sharp director. I have a license of that. I really like these tree maps because I think they are really intuitive. They give an impression that you see here, you own Microsoft via three ETFs to what amount. And it is, you see immediately how big they are in relation to each other compared to what you own here. At least of the same importance is the country distribution. Here again, you see that for this demo, Europe and the United States and Canada are about the same size. If I click on this segment, I again get the details. Perhaps in this case, the United Kingdom is a little bit underrepresented. I think in Europe, it should be up to Germany. In this case, both charts are chart directory charts. It is not easy in chart directory to identify a segment, but you don't have to worry about it because you will find an example in MBS. And generally, I have to say there are a lot of examples. And even if you don't find anything, just make a query on some search engine, you will find hundreds of examples. And those written in Python are especially easy to read. Another way to reduce your risk is that you have a certain percentage in government bonds, at least. I think that up to now, if the maturity day is not too far in the future, those of Germany are secure. You never know how it will develop, but I think now this is okay. And the good thing about bonds is you can exactly calculate how much money will I get back, and when will I get back that money. Therefore, I wanted to have a list showing me when will I be repayment, when will I get the coupon interest rates. This is a little bit limited only to bonds that pay their coupons once a year, and that will give you a payback to 100%. There are maybe a lot of variance, but for normal German government bonds, this is sufficient. Technically, I think that's quite interesting because these are desktop containers and they reside in something like a pseudo list box. That's something that Sojo doesn't offer out of the box. Well, when I had the idea that I needed something like that, I searched, as always, in the forum. And you see here that the example that I used was based on an idea of Charlie Robin. I don't think he's here today. And in general, I have to say that if you regularly read the forum, you can learn a lot of tricks and trips. In general, at least for my hobby projects, I really like Sojo. As a long-time developer, of course, know the big platforms like Java, like Net, like React.js, but they didn't seem to be natural fits for a Mac desktop application I wanted to do. My first prototype was written in Python. It was easy too, but the Qt graphics was something that wasn't appealing. Then the next try I did was going into Swift UI. It is an impressive platform, but I think I will never be a friend of Xcode. it is so chatty, I couldn't work. Perhaps if you work longer with it, it is okay. And then I remembered that in my young programmer's days, there was something like Real Basic, and from there to Sojo was not far away. So 2 years back, I was a beginner with Sojo, and I have to say, I really like API 2. I've seen there were a lot of discussions that it made a lot of effort to commercial developers, but the intention to give a consistent API to a beginner, I think, is really good. And what I like is the consistent naming of the events. I immediately know what they are doing. And this event-based programming still allows me to develop really quick. I'm, of course, experienced, but I have to say, from the first day on with Sojo, I was productive. Okay, that was my little application. Feel free to have questions. Oh, I can't tell you because I work 2 to 3 hours. I'm a retiree. I don't sometimes eat nights if I attend, and I don't count it. All in all, I think I've been working for 1 year, but only on some hours base. And it is, I think it's for all my projects, they are work in progress. If I get a new idea, might be I throw away 1/3 and write the next part. And that, at least in Sojo, isn't a problem. On normal internet pages from brokers, you will find the data. They have in general 3 categories: the countries, the percentage of the countries, the percentage of the holdings, and the percentage of the business sector. I would have liked to integrate the business sector too, but I didn't want to edit so much. Yes, as I told, I enter them manually because web services are not free. If any one of you can give me a hint where to find a free web service of that, I would be grateful. And throw away the list boxes. No, they are in ported via CVS. The ETFs I own, with all the data, of course, you make a CVS export in your custodian bank. I don't think that any custodian bank doesn't have a CVS export, and import them, and therefore I made it configurably when I changed the custodian bank that I don't have to reprogram anything. I don't keep the older ones, the history. What I keep, I can show you. I keep the performance by year, but not in relative percentages, because if you sell ETF or a share, that has a big percentage, a green percentage, and you immediately rebuy it to the same amount of shares, then mathematically it goes down to zero, maybe. But in absolute money, it will be the same. Therefore, for this long-term perspective, I'm only interested in the absolute money. But I don't keep track of a history, what has been 2 months ago or 3 months ago. And I don't even think for me it is that important. What I made, of course, is that I have links to internet pages in this case. It is not an ETF, but the NASDAQ index. And there, of course, you will find the history. So I make just a link there for that is editable. I don't want to reprogram what you will find at the internet. Okay, thanks for listening. Yeah.